Hello everyone, in this video we will cover the section 16.1. In this section we will see vector fields. The vectors in figure below are air velocity vectors that indicate the wind speed and direction at points 10 meters above the surface elevation in the San Francisco Bay Area. You see there are some different vector fields here. Red vector fields, yellow vector fields, white vector fields, and so on. So we see at a glance from the largest arrows in part A, the first one, there are largest arrows here, yellow ones, that the greatest wind speeds at that time occurred as the winds entered the bay across the Golden Gate Bridge. We obtain some information by using the vector fields about the speed of the wind and the direction of the wind. And the second part shows the very different wind pattern 12 hours earlier. Associated with every point in the air, we can imagine a wind velocity vector. So this is an example of a velocity vector field. This is an application for a velocity vector field. In general, a vector field is a function whose domain is a set of points in two-dimensional space or three-dimensional space, and whose range is a set of vectors in the vector space R square or R cube. Namely, we consider a vector field as a function such that its domain is a set of points in two-dimensional or three-dimensional coordinate system, and its range is a set of vectors in the vector space R square and R to the 3. The definition of a vector field, which is a function actually, is similar to the definition of the vector function, if you remember. By using vector functions, we state curves in two-dimensional and three-dimensional space. Similarly, we can state vector fields by using the vector field function. For a two-dimensional case, let's define vector field. Let capital D be a set in R square, a plane region, two-dimensional space. A vector field on R square is a function, capital bold F, that assigns to each point xy in the set D a two-dimensional vector bigger f of xy. Similarly, in three-dimensional space, let capital E be a subset of R cube. A vector field on R cube is a function, capital bold F, that assigns to each point x, y, z in the set E three-dimensional vector, capital bold F, x, y, z. If you remember from the chapter 13, the vector function, if you remember, a vector function is defined as stated by bold R, if you remember, it is a function from the set of real numbers to the three-dimensional vector space or two-dimensional vector space, okay? Or you can write R square. When we take a number from the set of real numbers, so the function assigns a vector written as f of t, g of t, and h of t. Okay, this is called a vector function. Namely, by writing just a number, if you know the component functions of the vector function Rt, by writing just by saying a number for the variable t, we obtain a vector. Every number corresponds to a vector in three-dimensional space. Similarly, a vector field in three-dimensional coordinate three-dimensional space or two-dimensional space, vector field is bigger f, bold f, which is a function from r cube or r square to again the three-dimensional space. The first one is considered as the set of points. The second one is considered as the set of vectors, because you know every point corresponds to its position vector. Therefore, when we take an ordered triple of numbers, it may be sometimes a point in the space, or it may be sometimes a vector. Therefore, the first R cube is considered as the set of points, and the second is considered as the set of vectors in three-dimensional space. When we take any point in R cube x, y, z, and we use the open parenthesis to state a vector to see the difference between the point and vector. So it corresponds to a vector written as a capital bold F, x, x, y, z is equal to. So now we write component functions. Every component function is a function of three variables, since we are interested in three-dimensional space. So it is equal to p of x, y, z, the standard basis vector I, which has the components 1, 0, 0, q, x, y, z, j, plus r, x, y, z, k. Okay. Namely, it is a vector such that we have p, q, and r, where p, q, and r functions, or p, q, and r are functions of three variables x, y, and z. Okay, x, y, and z. This is the difference between them. For the vector function, just we have one independent variable, which is t. But for the vector field, we have three independent variables. Or when we consider the second dimensional case, two-dimensional case, sorry, the component functions will be a function of two variables. Okay, this is the mathematical expression for a vector field generally. For two-dimensional space, the function bigger f is written as follows: p x y I plus q x y j, and the component functions are p and q. And also they are called scalar functions of two variables, and are sometimes called scalar fields to distinguish them from vector fields. Okay, they are scalar functions. Namely, the result will be a number for p and q after writing the necessary values for the variables x and y. So we will get a number for the result of the function p and q. And then we obtain a vector in two-dimensional space. Every point x, y can be corresponding to a vector. So when we consider every point in the domain of this function, so we will get infinitely many vectors. So all of them will form a vector field. All of them will form a vector field. For example, you can see a few vectors generally in two-dimensional or in three-dimensional space. We choose a few points from the domain of the vector field function, and then to see intuitively its graph in the coordinate system, and we catch arrows for every point here by considering its position according to the result of the function vector field. For example, this is an example for a few vectors in the vector field function f, and this is the three-dimensional version on R-cube. So a vector field on R-cube is pictured in this figure, and we can express it in terms of its component functions p, q, and r. As I said, this is the mathematical expression for the vector field. So we sometimes identify a point x, y, z with its position vector, if you remember, by considering the initial point as the origin. So every point becomes a vector in three-dimensional and two-dimensional space. So you know, we show vectors bold symbol like this one instead of x, y, z, instead of the point x, y, z. Therefore we use f of x shortly. Instead of bigger f of x, y, z, sometimes we write f of x to get a simple expression for the vector field function. Okay, so then vector field becomes a function that assigns a vector f of x to a vector x. Namely, it will be a function between the vector spaces. For example, a vector field on two-dimensional space is defined by f of xy is equal to minus yi plus x times j, namely p of xy is equal to minus y, and q of xy is equal to x. So describe a vector field f by sketching some of the vectors as in figure 3, like this one. What is the graphical version of this vector field? Let's consider here. So f of xy is defined as minus y I plus x j. First, let's consider the standard basis vectors on the two-dimensional space on R square on the xy plane, on the plane region. Namely, what is the image of I under the vector field I, or directly we can write f of 1, 0 is equal to j. F of 1, 0 is equal to j, and f of 0, 1, f of 0, 1, writing 0 for x and 1 for y, we get minus I 0, 1 minus I. And when we consider, for example, minus 1, 0, so x is minus 1, y is 0, so we get minus j. And f of 0 minus 1, for example, f of 0 minus 1 becomes, when we write minus 1 for y, we get plus I, and the second one is 0. So on R square, let's see the graph of the vectors x-axis, y-axis. So the point 1, 0, which is located here on the x-axis, correspond to the vector j, correspond to the vector J'dir. So the starting point is 1, 0. So we are in the positive direction since we have plus J. And J is actually lying on the y-axis, and its direction will be up. Therefore, when we consider the initial point as 1, 0, so the first vector will be in this form, okay? And this is the unit vector. This is parallel to the vector J, which is located on the which is located on the y-axis. So we sketch a vector parallel to this one. Okay, this is the position vector. This is the vector J. Okay, this is the second standard basis vector. And by considering the initial point as 1, 0 instead of the origin, so we get the same vector actually according to the result of the function big F. Okay. Similarly, when we consider 0, 1, which is here, okay, 0, 1, so for 0, 1, we get minus I, minus I. Normally, the vector I is in the direction located here. This is the vector I, okay. The terminal point is 1, 0. But we get minus I, namely, we will have in the opposite direction. We are in the opposite direction for the second vector, and the initial point is 0, 1. Initial point is 0, 1, which is 1. So the opposite direction will be the left side. Therefore, we sketch the same vector, this one, but the direction will be in the opposite one. This is the second one. And similarly, when we consider minus 1, 0, which is here, okay, minus 1, 0, and we have minus j, namely this one, the same vector, but we are in the opposite direction, and the initial point is minus 1, 0, and 0, minus 1 here, 0, minus 1, is corresponding to the vector I. The initial point is 0, minus 1, and we are in the same direction as the vector I. Therefore, we have graphically this vector for the last one, and so on. You can choose another points for this function, vector field function, and you can sketch another vectors. Like the graph, I show these ones, okay? And also you can write F22, which is this one, okay? The initial point is the point 2, 2, and when we choose the point 0 to 3, so it will be from here, actually, the second component is 3, so we have minus 3 times I, so we sketch the vector parallel to the vector I, like this one, okay, this one is the answer, actually, for the point 0 to 3, but its length will be 3 times the length of the vector I, therefore, its length is bigger than the length of the vector I, therefore, and it is in the opposite direction, therefore, the image of the point 0 to 3 under bigger F will be in this form, okay? And so, for some other special points, you see the answers, okay? And when we consider the unit circle for the vectors, when we sketch a circle passing through the point 1, 0, 0, 1, minus 1, 0, and 0, minus 1. This is the graph of the circle. Okay, you see these vectors become tangent vectors to the circle, the unit circle, namely its radius is equal to 1. These vectors become tangent vectors. Therefore, tangent, namely each arrow is tangent to a circle like this one you see, with center the origin. So to confirm this, we take the dot product of the position vector. Generally, x is the position vector of any point xi plus yj with the vector f of x y. X dot product f of x is equal to xi plus yj dot product y minus yi plus xj, namely x times minus y, which are the multiplication of the first components of the vectors, and y times x becomes zero. Why we do we multiply the vector field by the position vector of the point xy? Because it is actually for example, the position vector of the point 1, 0 is the vector I, and its dot product with the tangent vector is equal to 0 because the angle between them is 90 degree. So this shows that f of xy is perpendicular to the position vector and is therefore tangent to a circle with center the origin and radius is equal to the length of the vector x if we consider generally. Okay. So notice also that the length of the vector field is equal to the length of the vector x, which is the position vector. So the magnitude of the vector is equal to the radius of the circle. Okay. So some computer algebra systems are capable of plotting vector fields. You can see graphically some graphs for vector fields. For example, it is defined minus yx. This is the example that we saw here. And another example is written here. When we consider the point xy, so we obtain a vector y sine x. And this is another one. When we consider a point xy, namely when we know the values of x and y, we can find a vector by considering the component functions. Here we have logarithmic functions ln 1 plus y square and ln 1 plus x square. By computing for some special points, we will see intuitively the graph of this vector field. For example, this one is the vector field defined by minus y and x. You see, we have always tangent vectors to the circle with radius x. If a vector is perpendicular to the position vector xy, which means actually from here we can see when we choose a vector, a point on the unit circle, and its position vector will be this one, and when we sketch it's also a tangent vector, so we see always the position vector will be perpendicular to the tangent vector. So since we have this information, when we find the dot product of the position vector and the vector function is equal to zero, that means f of x is always the tangent vector to the circle with radius the length of the vector x. Therefore we say the vector field function gives always a tangent vector to the circle. Okay. Let's sketch the vector field on R cube given by f of x y z is equal to z times k. So just we have the third component for the vector, namely it is actually 0, 0, z. Therefore we will always obtain vertical vectors like this one, since the first and second component are equal to 0. So and when we consider points close to the xy plane, so the lengths will be very little, but when we consider the points, namely the magnitude increases with the distance from the xy plane, okay, the length, the magnitude of the vectors increases if the distance between the point and the xy plane is bigger than the previous one, like this one, for example. This one is close to the xy plane than the point which is here. Therefore, its magnitude is less than the magnitude of the vector which is here. Okay, and you can see some examples in three-dimensional space here. In three-dimensional space, for example, f of x, y, z is defined as y I plus z j and plus x k, and you can see the directions of the vector. You can see like the it is similar to the example, and when we consider y I minus 2j plus x k, namely the second component is constant, and you can see the directions of the vectors. This is very interesting, and this one has the components y over z minus x over z and z over 4, and you see the directions and the magnitudes for every vector. Okay, so we notice that the vector fields in figure 10 and 11 have similar formulas. The difference between them just is the second component function. We have the variable z, but here we have a constant, but all the vectors in figure 11 point in the general direction of the negative y-axis because their components are all 2, minus 2. If the vector field in figure 12 represents a velocity field, then a particle will be swept upward and will spiral around the z-axis in the clockwise direction as viewed from above. Okay. So imagine a fluid flowing steadily along a pipe. Let bolt V, capital V, x, y, z be the velocity vector at a point x, y, z. Then V assigns a vector to each point x, y, z in a certain domain, the interior of the pipe, you see. And so V is a vector field on R cube called a velocity field. A possible velocity field is illustrated in this figure, namely velocity field in fluid flow, namely by using the velocity field, namely the vector field function. By using the vector field function, we can see the direction and the speed of the fluid inside the pipe, you see. Okay. So the speed at any given point is indicated by the length of the arrow. We can compute the speed of the fluid inside the pipe by using the length of the vector, which is found by finding the length of the vector field function, namely the velocity field function. Okay. There are many applications of vector fields in applied science. This is another example. Newton's law of gravitation states that the magnitude of the gravitational force between two objects with masses little m and bigger m is given here, where r is the distance between the objects. We have two objects, and capital G is the gravitational constant. This is an example of an inverse square law. Let's assume that the object with mass bigger M is located at the origin in R cube. For instance, M could be the mass of the Earth, and the origin would be at its center, like this one. Okay, this is the object with mass M, and its center is the origin. And let the position vector of the object with mass little m be the vector x has the components x, y, and z. This one, for example. So the distance from the origin to the point x, y, z is the length of the vector x, which is the radius, actually, of the first object. So from here we have r square is equal to the length of the vector x square. So the gravitational force exerted on this second object acts toward the origin. Namely, the directions will be accord toward the origin. And the unit vector in this direction will be minus x over the length of the vector x, since we are in the opposite direction. Therefore, the gravitational force acting on the object vector x, we consider the point as its position vector, is equal to, instead of r square, we write, namely, for this one, we write a vector field function, actually, which is written here. We have the vector x, and we have its coefficient here. Physicists often use the notation r instead of x for the position vector, so you may see formula 3 written in the form, instead of x we write just r. So the function given by equation 3 is an example of a vector field in physics called the gravitational field. Okay, called the gravitational field, because it associates a vector with every point x in space. In for every point we have a vector, which is called the gravitational vector field. And also, by using the components of the vector x, formula 3, by using the components of the vector x, so we can also write this vector field in terms of its component functions by using the facts that x has the components x, y, and z generally, and its length will be the square root of the addition of the squares of the components. Therefore, the first component, so we have the constant here. We have the coefficient, so if we consider just x over the length of the vector x to the power 3, so the first component will be x over the length of the vector x to the power 3, which is written as x squared plus y squared plus z squared to the power 3 over 2. Okay, x squared plus y squared plus z squared to the power 3 over 2, because we have square root here. And similarly, you can write the second and third component and multiplying by the coefficient, so you will obtain the component functions in this form. Okay, this is another way for writing the vector field function for the gravitational field. Another example: suppose an electric charge capital Q is located at the origin. According to the Coulomb's law, the electric force exerted by this charge on a charge Q located at a point x, y, z with position vector bold x is defined in this form. You see, for every point we have a vector, therefore this is another example of the vector field, where epsilon is a constant that depends on the units used. you can remember from your physics lectures. For like charges, we have Q times capital Q bigger than zero, and the force is repulsive. For unlike charges, we have negative one, so and force is attractive. So notice the similarity between formulas 3 and 4. Instead of little m and bigger m, we have little q and bigger q, and instead of bigger g, we have the epsilon. Okay, so both vector fields are examples of force fields. Instead of considering the electric force, physicists often consider the force per unit charge. Namely, we will divide by q this one. So we obtain epsilon times capital Q over the length of the vector x to the power 3 times the vector x. So then it is a vector field on three-dimensional space called the electric field of the electric charge capital Q. You see, we use a lot of times the vector field in applied science. So another example is the gradient fields, you know, from the section 14.6. If f is a scalar function of two variables, namely z is equal to f of xy is a scalar function of the variables x and y, we get a number. So the gradient of this function, if you remember, is defined by fxi plus fij, namely it is a vector and the components are the first partial derivatives fx and fy, if you remember from the section 14.6. Therefore, gradient of the function f is really a vector field on two-dimensional space, and it is called a gradient vector field. Likewise, if f is a scalar function of three variables, so we have three components, which are the first partial derivatives of the function f with respect to the independent variables x, y, and z respectively. And another example, find the gradient vector field of the function f defined here. Plot the gradient vector field together with a counter map of f. For example, if just we will find the partial derivatives of the function f easily. The partial derivative of f with respect to x is equal to, namely y is a constant. So the derivative of x squared is 2x times y. And the derivative of the function f with respect to y is x squared is a constant, minus 3 times y to the power 2. And using a computer program, we can see the counter map and the vectors, which represents the vector field, gradient field actually. This figure shows a counter map. You see, this is the level curves actually of the function f with the gradient vector field. You see the directions of the gradient vectors for every point. So notice that the gradient vectors are perpendicular to the level curves, as we would expect from the section 14.6, because if you remember, the gradient vectors of the function f are orthogonal to the tangent vector of the level curves. Therefore, they are perpendicular to the level curves. And a vector field, big F, is called a conservative vector field. This is an important definition. A vector field, big F, is called a conservative vector field if it is the gradient of some scalar function. In other words, if there exists a function little f such that the gradient vector is equal to some vector field, in this situation little f is called a potential function for vector field function big F. If the gradient vector is equal to the vector field function bigger f, bold f, so it, little f is called a potential function for f, and bigger f is called a conservative vector field. Thank you very much.